Good morning and welcome to De La Salle's Virtual Remembrance Day Ceremony. Annually, November 11th serves as a reminder for the sacrifices made by the brave men and women, both past and present. This year marks the 75th anniversary of the contribution of the Canadian Armed Forces in bringing an end to World War II. Our countrymen and women liberated the Netherlands from Nazi occupation. The 1st Canadian Army played a major role in the liberation of the Dutch people who had suffered terrible hunger and hardship under the increasingly desperate German occupiers. The 1st Canadian Army also played a leading role in the opening of Belgium and the Netherlands' Scheldt estuary, the gateway to the port of Antwerp. Access to this port was essential to maintain supply lines to the Allied armies as they continued their push toward Germany to defeat Hitler and his forces and free Western Europe from 4 years of Nazi occupation, which had begun in April of 1940. Those who fought in the liberation of the Netherlands achieved and sacrificed much in their efforts to help bring peace and freedom to the people of Europe. These combatants were among the more than 1 million men and women who served in Canada's armed forces during the Second World War. More than 42,000 Canadians gave their lives in the war. Canada and the world recognize the sacrifices and achievements of all the Canadians, like those who fought in the liberation of the Netherlands, who accomplished so much and left a lasting legacy of peace. More than 7,600 Canadians died in the 9 dreadful months it took to liberate the Netherlands. They are buried in cemeteries from Belgium to Germany. In the 21st century, Canadian forces are involved in active operations in North America, Europe, Africa, the Middle East, and Asia. While the issues and conflicts are often far removed from our day-to-day lives, today we commemorate that for many military families, current and past, the losses and hardships are far too real. The efforts of our servicemen and women, past and present, are recognized, appreciated, and commemorated.
Let us remember that we are in the holy presence of God. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. In her book, A Terrible Beauty, The Art of Canada at War, Heather Robertson writes, "We must remember. If we do not, the sacrifice of those 100,000 Canadian lives will be meaningless. They died for us, for their homes and families and friends, for a collection of traditions they cherished and a future they believed in. They died for Canada. The meaning of their sacrifice rests with our collective national consciousness. Our future is their monument. These wars touched the lives of Canadians of all ages, all races, all social classes. Fathers, sons, daughters, sweethearts were killed in action, were wounded, and many of those who returned were forever changed. Those who stayed in Canada also served, in factories, in volunteer service organizations, wherever they were needed."
Yet, for many of us, war is a phenomenon viewed on a screen or in someone's written account of battles fought in distant parts of the world. Our closest physical and emotional experience may be the discovery of wartime memorabilia in a family attic, or in listening to someone speak, or attending a Remembrance Day ceremony like this one. But even items such as photographs, uniform badges, medals, diaries can seem vague and unconnected to the life of their owner. For those of us who were born during peacetime, all wars appear to be far removed from our daily activities.
As Canadians, we often take for granted our current way of life, our freedom to participate in cultural and political events, and our right to live under a government of our choice. The Charter of Rights and Freedoms in our Constitution ensures that all Canadians enjoy protection under the law. The Canadians who went off to war in distant lands went in the belief that such rights and freedoms were being threatened. They truly believed what the late King George VI said in 1939, "Without freedom, there can be no enduring peace, and without peace, no enduring freedom." In remembering their service and their sacrifice, we recognize the tradition of freedom they fought to preserve. These men and women had faith in the future, and by their acts gave us the will to preserve peace for all time. On Remembrance Day, we acknowledge the courage and gallantry of those who served for their country. During times of war, individual acts of heroism occurred frequently. Only a few were recorded and received official recognition. In remembering all those who served, we recognize the many who willingly endured the hardships and the fear so that we could live in peace.
A reading from the Book of Wisdom. But the souls of the just are in the hand of God, and no torment shall touch them. They seemed, in the view of the foolish, to be dead, and their passing away was thought an affliction, and their going forth from us, utter destruction. But they are in peace. For if before men, indeed, they be punished, yet it is their hope full of immortality, chastised a little, they shall be greatly blessed, because God tried them and found them worthy of himself. As gold in the furnace, he proved them, and as sacrificial offerings, he took them to himself. In the time of their visitation, they shall shine, and shall dart about as sparks through stubble. They shall judge nations and rule over peoples, and the Lord shall be their king forever. Those who trust in him shall understand truth, and the faithful shall abide with him in love, because grace and mercy are with his holy ones, and his care is with the elect. St. John Baptiste de La Salle, live Jesus in our hearts.
We do not know whose son he was.
We do not know his name.
We do not know if he was a McPherson or a Chartrand.
He could have been a Kaminsky or a Swift Arrow.
We do not know if he was a father himself.
We do not know if his mother or wife received that telegram with the words, "Missing in action," read with electrifying clarity.
We do not know whether he had begun to live his life as a truck driver or a miner, or a teacher, or a scientist, or a student.
Did he have brown eyes?
Did he know what it was to love someone and to be loved back?
Was he a father who had not seen his child?
Did he love hockey? Did he play defense?
Did he play football? Could he kick a field goal?
Did he like to fix cars? Did he dream of owning a Buick?
Did he read poetry?
Did he have freckles?
Did he think nobody understood him?
We will never know the answers to these questions.
We will never know him.
But we honor him as someone who could have been all these things and now is no more.
We who are left have questions that only he could answer.
And no honor we can do him can give him the future that was destroyed when he was killed.
We honor that life stop by doing one's duty, the end of a future, the death of dreams.
We give thanks to those who were willing to sacrifice themselves, who gave their youth and their future so that
we can live in peace.
Because we do not know him, we do not know what he could become. He has become more than one body, more than one grave.
He is a symbol of all sacrifice.
He is every soldier in all our wars.
This man, who is unknown by name, is known in the hearts of all Canadians.
He is known for the values that we respect: selflessness, honor, courage, and commitment.
The wars fought in the 20th century were not for the purpose of uniting Canada.
The country that emerged was forged in sacrifice.
We will not forget that.
We will remember.
I remember Private Thomas Joseph Lee, who served in the Canadian Infantry Alberta Regiment during World War I. He died on October the 8th, 1916.
I remember Private Daniel Monkman, who served in the 1st Canadian Mounted Rifles Saskatchewan Regiment during World War I. He was born April 7th, 1896, and died October 13th, 1916, at the age of 20.
I remember Private Abraham Farmer, who served in the Canadian Machine Gun Corps in the First World War. Born December 24th, 1881, died November 22nd, 1916.
I remember Private Albert Henry Cake, who served in the Canadian Infantry during World War I. Born November 29th, 1883, died April 8th, 1917.
Remember Sergeant George Douglas Adams, who served in the 48th Highlanders of Canada unit during World War II. Born on August 4th, 1915, died on October 14th, 1944.
I remember Private Patrick Joseph Ryle, who served in the Royal Navy during the First World War, who died June 12th, 1918.
I remember Private Michael Capley, who worked in the Canadian Machine Gun Corps. He was born on July 27th, 1893, and died at age 25 fighting in the First World War.
I remember Private Aaron Bailey, who served in the Canadian Infantry during World War I. Born May 14th, 1892, and died April 27th, 1916.
I remember Private Robert Russell, who served in the Argyle and Sutherland Highlanders during World War II. Born in 1915, died October 7th, 1944.
I remember Agnes Estelle Allpow, who served in the Canadian Military Medical Corps during World War I. Born July 5th, 1891, died October 12th, 1918.
Here lies Private Alexander Smith, who served in the Canadian Infantry during World War I. He was born May 1878 and died July 1916.
I remember Private William Marks, who served in the Canadian Infantry Central Ontario Regiment during World War I. He was born on October 9, 1896 and died on April 26, 1915 at the age of 18.
There was a lot of patriotism in those days. Many people thought about king and country, quite unusual for today, but in those days,
Many of the boys, just about all the boys on my street, joined the military because they thought it was the thing to do, just like I did. I found it very exciting, actually. I found my days in those days being in a movie because everything was moving so fast and we were really well received by the population. Everywhere we went, if you were a soldier, the girls come around and the boys thought we were heroes. And we went to Union Station in Toronto. Coming to and from our camp, you were looked upon as somebody heroic. I think it's usual for you today to think about that, but in those days, it really was a great thing to be a soldier. Because I was young, don't forget. You gotta remember, when you're 18 years old, you think you can conquer anything.
You don't have, you're scared out of your mind, but you're used to get going. Whereas anybody over 20 had a few more brains, you know. But anyway, I ran across Av Road, and there were no Germans in the trenches. They got out. By the time we had organized, they had taken off. I set the Bren gun up, and I picked some shots, and all of a sudden, bam! I thought I'd been hit with a 2x4. If you can imagine being hit right across your butt, I get hit in the right arm, by the way. But I mean, it just felt like somebody had just bang like that. And I didn't know I'd got hit, because I thought, what's happened? The roof has fallen in on me or something. And I fell back, of course, and I scared the hell out of everybody else around me because everybody wondered where the hell did it come from. God, when I woke up next morning, the ward was full of soldiers, but you know what? Half of them were Germans. German soldiers beside me. One on each side. Can you imagine? And I thought, holy mackerel, German soldiers. Right. First of all, I thought maybe I was a prisoner, but then I saw we had Dutch soldiers on guard on all the ward with the rifles standing on guard. And there I was trying to make sense out of talking to somebody. I was in a daze. They don't forget, what are you, a guy who's talking to me in German? And it took me a while then. But then one of the most beautiful things happened in my whole life. A Canadian nurse came along. I'm telling you, you have to. It's beyond, it's almost like when you're looking at a baby, I don't know what it is, but when she came upon the scene and she put a hand on my shoulders and on my head and she said, you're going to be all right, John. And she called me John. Isn't that nice? It wasn't sort of Mr. Preacher when it, and she was so sweet and nice, and I said, you're going to be okay.
You did your assignments, which are just like there would be in any hospital. Maybe you're in charge of penicillin, maybe you're in charge of dressing, maybe you're in charge of just the pill part of it, or else you were helping. You were helping patients, you know, really encouraging them. And you would talk to them all the time because, you know, when they're crying at night, it's just so awful. And they want their mothers, you know, that's all they want. So the sisters would take time and really talk to the chap, you know, rub his back and light him a cigarette. And if he didn't have a hand to hold it, maybe hold it for him. One of his buddies would always do that, you know? And it really did help them. You know, the ones that had hands would help the ones that didn't. And it was just very wonderful. But I think they saw us like sisters, or you know what I mean, like a part of a family. And you know, that motherly instinct that all women have, I think really helped with the soldiers, especially for the very, very young ones, because they were just so far from home. And you know, maybe they hadn't gotten letters in over a month and they were just very worried about their families. So we could talk to them and really help them at the same time, you know?
I think we were all people doing jobs that were assigned to us. The infantry fought on their legs with their gun. The engineers built bridges and roads. The service people brought us all the equipment we needed. The Remy repaired everything. Everybody had a specific function depending on what units they belonged to. And so the whole total effort came together. And I think that was what was the wonderful thing about it. And I don't think you see that in movies. I don't know, because as I say, I haven't really seen many. But the total effort combined was, I think, what paid off of everybody doing their best. You couldn't help but think of those guys going out day after day with their life on the line and living in little slit trenches that wouldn't give you any protection at all. We were fortunate. We were cared for. We were looked after. We respected what they did and why they were doing it. And we were so grateful when they were successful. There was a very deep respect for the nursing. The sisters were their friends. And we weren't as maybe as strict, as their male officers that they knew. They knew we were officers. They respected us for that. But I think there was a real tender feeling towards the nurses because they were the closest thing to home that they had.
But anyway, then later in the night, the same nurse, I don't know, these must have been on 24 hours a day. In the middle of the night, she came upon me and she said, "John, you're going to be okay, but gangrene has set in. We got to get you to England." And I said, "Well, I'm glad. I don't ever want to go back to action again." She said, "Oh, good, because you're going to be okay, and we'll look after you, and you just take it easy." And I was there 2 or 3 days, lying there, half in and out. And that nurse, she left me with the feelings that I'll never forget. I'll never forget ever. Like it's almost like you talk about love, a love affair, or love. The kind of unconditional thing that when she looked at me and touched me, there's nothing to compare with it.
I was on night duty. I can remember that so well. And the first thing we did was we tore off all the windows, of course. They were blacked out, So we tore off all the black curtains, and I remember the lights. I hadn't seen lights in so long. And the lights came on in the cathedral, and we looked down on the city, and there was lights in the cathedral and on the streets, and it was unforgettable. And one thing that people forget, is that the wounded boys, of course, they were ecstatic for a day or two, but then they started to realize, I'm going home. I'm going home without an arm or without a leg or with shrapnel still in or half a face missing. And along with all the elation was a lot of deep thinking. What am I going to do now?
At this point, I just have to remark again on the they're all heroes. Camaraderie and the sense of humor. The minute the boys got feeling stable at all, somehow that sense of humor came. And they'd look at the fellow next door and say, "Well, I'm glad I haven't got maybe one's without a leg and the other's the next boy's without a hand and the next boy's got shrapnel all over him." They seem to make the best of, that sounds funny, make the best of their wounds, and the first, once they got on their feet, they'd come right to us and say, "What can we do to help?" And that was a great help because we'd have somebody look for the blood, their blood dripping or the intravenous, and then some poor chap with the arms or anything, he'd sit and give them a cigarette or run errands for I always say, I really think war brings out maybe the worst, but brings out the best in people.
I tell them the horrors of war. I explain to them what a combat soldier goes through. I don't polish it up and make it something that you'd love to do. I tell them how rotten it is, how stinking rotten it is when you have to go to the toilet in the place that you're living in and so forth. You can't run down to McDonald's and get a hamburger, go up to the corner and get a bottle of Coke and a cigar or a chocolate bar. And they seem to realize this then. They don't, when they see a soldier in uniform, they don't realize what he's going through. This is what I tell them anyway. I don't know. I tell them the horrors of war and hope the hell it doesn't happen to them. That's about it.
And we go to lots of schools before Remembrance Day, old folks home, different towns, give speeches to the high school kids. Are really asking lots of questions and very interested. And every year we go do that. And you see, you guys can still talk so many years. I said, "What can we do?" I have to tell you guys, when you grow up, you'll know who your parents were, who your friend was, and when we were gone, so you'll know how to preach to other people. Think back, about your, some of your pals never will see the world again. And left their lives there, you know, and you've saved, trying to save their life, but couldn't do it. But you came back. Something like, lots of these, like we go to funerals, we have these ceremony funerals. People say, well, how are you guys doing, sir? You give such a nice service for our bodies that died, or mother or father or whatever. He said, it's one of our guys. We fought together. See, we got to pay respect to them so the parents or brother or sister would know that we still care for them.
If you love the country, you got to be prepared to fight for it. Yeah, and that goes with everything, with country or family or whatever. So I'm not keen on the what individualism sometimes goes too little too far, that you got to live for more than yourself. And I would hope that, I wish our schools would do more to make, to bring back some of the old verities that we used to go by, you know. And all of my day was king and country and all that crap. But and I'm not saying we should go back to that, but I don't feel the kids these days are getting enough appreciation for their country, for their family, and for the old time things about do unto others as you would have others do unto you. I was asked to talk to a bunch of kids in the school about a few years ago, and I had to say, look around, look at different colors and different people. Do you know that in my day, we were supposed to want to kill the Japs, we wanted to kill the Germans. How would you like to think like that? You see, you got to watch where we're going, where the whole country's going. We got to start. We got to learn to love each other.
Thank you. beaches now. Sir, I think he's bleeding out. And some things you just can't speak about. With you I surf, with you I fall down, down. Watch you breathe in, watch you breathe in. Thank you.
forest fields the poppies blow, between the crosses row on row, that mark our place, and in the sky the larks still bravely singing fly, scarce heard amid the guns below.
We are the dead!
Short days ago, we lived, felt dawn, saw sunset glow, loved and were loved, and now we lie in Flanders fields.
With the foe, to you from failing hands we throw. The torch be yours to hold it high, if ye break faith with us to die, we shall not sleep.
Though poppies grow in Flanders fields.